and welcome to Mindscapes, our series of conversations with men and women whose ideas, vision, and philosophy define our contemporary world. My guest today is a meditation master with a following, an influence, and impact around the world. He's taught people that have ranged from the movers and shakers at the World Economic Forum in Davos, at prisons, bureaucrats, members of parliament, schools, colleges, and a large community. I'm delighted to welcome Acharya Satyanarayan Goenka. You are a meditation teacher, and there are so many different forms of meditation and some confusion about what meditation really is. What is meditation?
The word meditation carries a meaning as if we have an object and we keep on concentrating our mind on it and get submerged in it. But this is not so. This is awareness. Awareness of the totality of the body, body and mind, the interaction of body and mind. One keeps on observing it, the influence of body on the mind, the influence of mind on the body. And because of one's ignorance as to what is happening at the depth of the mind, the reaction of defilement starts, craving, aversion, which keeps on multiplying at the root level, and then keeps on overpowering one, and then one is helpless and performs such unwholesome actions at the vocal level, at the physical level, for which one repents later.
Your, the form of meditation that you teach, Vipassana, is sort of roughly translated, I suppose, in some strands of English translation as mindfulness.
Mindfulness, yes.
Training in mindfulness.
Right.
You have also taught that this derives from the teachings of the Buddha.
Yes, certainly.
To what degree is this circumscribed by Buddha's other teachings and philosophies, such as the Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Middle Path? To what degree is a commitment or an understanding of those explanations and systems important to the practice of Vipassana?
This is what it is. The Four Noble Truths is being experienced. The Eightfold Noble Path is being experienced. And this is Vipassana. You experience the truth. It is not an intellectual game. It is not just a philosophy to accept it at the emotional level or devotional level or even an intellectual level. One has to experience the truth. What is dukkha? What is misery? And observing the misery, one finds the cause of the misery at the experiential level. And observing that cause, one finds out the way how to come out of it. And one reaches the stage where entire misery is gone.
So is there a scriptural, a textual, a philosophical, intellectual, as you said, a context from which you approach these teachings? Or is it purely experiential? And it doesn't need the verbalization, the concretization in concepts and thought.
Quite. Nothing to do with concepts, nothing to do with thoughts, nothing to do with imagination. The reality as it is. And this is explained in the words of Buddha himself. Again and again, he has been emphasizing on these two words, jhana, passa. Passa means experience. Passa means to see also, to observe also. But actually, where the technique is concerned, it means to feel, to experience. And jhana, you get your knowledge with your own experience. Not a book knowledge, not something that you know by discussions or by intellectualization, but real experience.
You'd mentioned that sometimes if we are not mindful, because of defilements, we could do actions which are, we repent later.
Right.
Is there a moral framework that circumscribes Vipassana?
Right. The base of Vipassana is the Eightfold Noble Path, which is divided in three sections: Sila, morality; Samadhi, mastery over the mind; and Panya, wisdom. You purify your mind, the totality of the mind, not just the surface of the mind, by developing your own wisdom. So all these three are there, and the base is morality, certainly. Without this, other two steps cannot be taken.
So do you then sort of require of your students that they follow these moral structures, frameworks, guidelines in order to be more effective practitioners?
That is true. That is true, because that is the foundation of the entire technique of Vipassana. If the foundation goes weak, the entire structure of meditation will collapse. One does not get any benefit. So when people come, they take 5 precepts, at least for those 10 days when they are practicing it, they are supposed not to break any one of these 5 precepts. After that, they are their own masters. If they find that it's very good, that I must observe these precepts for the whole life, wonderful, and many people start observing. Otherwise, if not 5, maybe 4, maybe 3, but they start observing. Without that, the samadhi, concentration of mind in a right way, is not possible. And unless there is a samadhi, samyak samadhi, samma samadhi, you can't have wisdom, you can't have pragya, you can't have panya. So all these, sila is for samadhi, samadhi is for pragya, and pragya is for liberation.
So you've used the word a number of times, wisdom. Vipassana assumes that the wisdom is inherent, is already there, and somehow there are defilements which need to be removed or handled or disappear, and natural spontaneous wisdom will emerge.
Right. Normally, the so-called surface of the mind, which is a very small part of the mind. And Buddha used the word paritta, that means parimitta, very small part of the mind. And one keeps on working at this level only, where the intellect works. But the bigger part of the mind constantly is a prisoner of its own habit pattern. And the habit pattern of that part of the mind is that the root level is constantly reacting to the sensations on the body. If one feels a pleasant sensation, one immediately reacts with craving. Unpleasant sensation, immediately reacts with aversion. And they are all the time, day and night, pleasant, unpleasant, sometimes neutral sensations are there throughout the body. And the habit pattern of the mind at the root level has become such that it keeps on reacting. Now this technique takes one to go to that depth and feel the body sensations and feel how the mind is reacting. And one starts changing the habit pattern by understanding that the entire physical structure, the entire mental structure, the combination of the two, look, it is constantly changing. All the time in a flux, in a flow, again, not an intellectual game. One feels arising, passing with great rapidity. Oh, something which is so ephemeral, however pleasant it may be, there is no meaning, no purpose of reacting with craving or generating any kind of attachment to it. Similarly, unpleasant sensation comes. It is also arising, passing. There is no meaning, no purpose of generating aversion towards it. It is passing away.
Given this sort of intimate relationship between mind and body, modern research is looking at the biochemistry of the brain, and a lot of work is being done on using chemicals to deal with mental illness, to deal with depression, to deal with schizophrenia,
right.
How does Vipassana view the developments in the biochemistry of the brain, particularly in treating mental illness?
With my study of Buddha's practical teaching of Vipassana and Buddha's teaching in his own words in the Pali language, I found that he was not a founder of any religion, no religion. To me, he was a super scientist. He discovered certain things which were already there, but he discovered. One important thing that he found out was that the apparent level it looks that one is reacting to the sensual objects. When a shape, a form, a color comes in contact with the eyes, one reacts. If one likes it, then reacts with craving. If dislikes, reacts with aversion. Similarly, sound for the ear, smell for the nose, taste for the tongue, touch for the body, and a thought for the mind. When they come in contact, you react. This was the belief even before Buddha. Mm-hmm. This is belief even after Buddha in India. Mm-hmm. What he discovered was, you are not reacting to these sensual objects. The sensual objects coming in contact with your sense doors and your reaction, there is a missing link, and that missing link is a sensation on the body. Mm-hmm. As soon as something comes in contact, there is a sensation in the body which is natural. Mm-hmm. And then another part of the mind recognizes it, watch, and gives valuation. Oh, good, bad, mm-hmm. Word has come, what word? Mm-hmm. Word of abuse. Word of praise, word of abuse, oh very bad, word of praise, oh wonderful. Mm-hmm. And this very neutral sensation changes. When one says wonderful, very good, it changes into pleasant sensation. Mm-hmm. Oh very bad, unpleasant sensation. Mm-hmm. And then one starts reacting. Mm-hmm. Although it all happens so quickly, mm-hmm. that one always remains apparent truth. Oh, I am reacting to the words, I am reacting to the shape, to the form. When you go to the depth, it becomes so clear, Buddha's words become so clear, you are reacting to the body sensations. Mm-hmm. Now these body sensations, you talked about biochemicals. He uses the word ashrava. Mm-hmm. Ashrava means a flow. Mm-hmm. With the stream of the blood, a biochemical starts flowing. As soon as one generates anger, a particular biochemical starts flowing, which is very unpleasant. And because it is very unpleasant, one again reacts with anger. Mm-hmm. One reacts with anger, and this ashrava becomes stronger, mm-hmm. and a vicious circle starts. Mm-hmm. The same thing with all the defilements of the mind. Passion, a particular type of biochemical will start. Mm-hmm. Fear, a particular type. Depression, a particular type. Ego, a particular type. Every defilement of the mind generates the secretion of a particular biochemical which starts flowing with the stream of the blood, mm-hmm. and one, without knowing what's happening, one keeps on reacting to it, and one keeps on multiplying the defilement.
You have been at pains to emphasize that the practice of Vipassana is essentially secular and can coexist with no matter what one's faith or exactly. practice or religion
right,
is.
Right, right, right.
And yet this does derive from the teachings of the Buddha.
Yeah.
The teachings of the Buddha made some assumptions about fact of reincarnation, of aspects of subtle mind. There were some sort of essentially Buddhist concepts. How does this translate into a secular vocabulary?
Let me tell you. Buddha never taught Buddhism. Buddha never made a single person a Buddhist. Mm-hmm. Entire words of Buddha, which are contained in about 15,000 pages, and then the commentaries and sub-commentaries, total about 55,000 pages, large literature, mm-hmm. and we have put everything in the CD-ROM, mm-hmm. and there is a research program in it. Mm-hmm. Nowhere the word Buddha is available there. Mm-hmm. Whatever he teaches, he says Dhamma, that is Dharma, that is law, that is truth, law of nature, universal law of nature, mm-hmm. and those who follow, he never tells them Buddha, he says Dhammiko, Dharmik. Dharmik, Dhammattho, Dharmisht, these are the words he is using. And we are making research and we have found till about 500 years, this word Buddhism or Buddhist, Bodha Dharm or Bodha or Bodha Darshan was never used. I don't know when it started. And I feel when this word started, maybe innocently or maybe with some bad intention, I cannot say. When this word started being used for the teaching of Buddha, for the followers of Buddha, mm-hmm. I feel it was a degradation of Buddha's teaching. Mm-hmm. Because then it becomes a sect. Mm-hmm. The moment you say Buddhism, mm-hmm. it becomes a sect. Mm-hmm. The moment you say Buddhist, mm-hmm. it becomes a sectarian. Mm-hmm. He never used those words. Mm-hmm. And in his teaching, I find, he was so very much against this caste system. Mm-hmm. One is not high or low because of one takes birth from this mother or that mother. Exactly in the same way, he was against all sorts of sectarianism. Mm-hmm. One is not high or low because of this sect or that sect, mm-hmm. only because of karma. Mm-hmm. What one's action is. If action is good, one is a higher person. Action is bad, one is a lower person. Mm-hmm. His teaching is so clear and so universal, so non-sectarian.
Is there any space in Vipassana or alongside it for prayer, for ritual, for the practices of of different faiths and religions, you normally associate spirituality with at least the notion of prayer.
It is not a religion at all. Mm-hmm. In Buddha's teaching, nowhere we find a trace of prayer. No prayer. You have to work on your own salvation. Mm-hmm. Somebody can just show you the path. Buddha says, I can only show the path. The Buddha only shows the path, entire journey one has to make oneself.
So what is the role of the teacher, of the guru?
Just to show the path. Mm-hmm. One who has walked on the path, has experience on the path, will say, well look, step by step, you have to walk on the path like this, that's all. Mm-hmm. Unless somebody walks on the path, mm-hmm. one cannot reach the goal. Mm-hmm. Every step that one takes, mm-hmm. makes this person nearer to the goal. Mm-hmm. Every step takes him nearer to the goal. Mm-hmm. But every step, one has to take oneself.
Is the relationship of the guru in Vipassana as intense as we have traditionally learned it is, shall we say, or has been practiced in Hinduism, where in fact when you take on a guru, there is you surrender your karma, and that becomes a sort of a very intense surrender. Does one still keep one's analytical, critical faculties alive in looking at the guru?
Nothing at all. There is no gurudom involved. No gurudom. The words of Buddha are so clear. Tume hi kichang atappang akha taro tathagata. You have to work out your own salvation. Buddha will only show the path. So the same role is played by the teacher. He shows the path. A teacher cannot liberate somebody.
So what are the qualities of the perfect teacher?
Well, when I was made a teacher, then my teacher examined me and he found out something good in me, then that's why he made me a teacher. What I do, first thing, one must be quite perfect in the technique so that no deviation is made. One shows the right path, one important thing. Second important thing, one should have experienced that oneself, at least to a certain extent, up to which one can guide others. Third important thing, one must have developed a lot of love, compassion, goodwill, mm-hmm. selfless service. If these qualities are not there, mm-hmm. we can't train somebody to be a teacher. Mm-hmm. And another important thing, because the work is now taken up by the householders, mm-hmm. and householder, if he teaches, he will start spreading the palm, mm-hmm. asking some money, mm-hmm. which is totally prohibited. Mm-hmm. So every teacher, everyone whom we train as a teacher, must have a means of livelihood. Another means of livelihood. Mm-hmm. And this he must give free service. Mm-hmm. These are the four qualities on the basis of which we train people to become teachers.
Do you feel in your striving, you know, your it was what, 30, more than 30 years ago, in the late 60s, that this was a practice that came to you and you started teaching in India. Do you experience any imperfections yourself, any striving yourself?
I don't think. It was so easy. When I came, of course, there was a doubt in my mind, because these are residential courses. Who will arrange a 10-day course for me?
Well, we should just explain to our viewers that what you really organize for people who start the practice of Vipassana mm-hmm. is a residential 10-day course where they come in and they sort of, as it's a residential course, they're not in touch with the outside world.
Quite.
And they give up the use of any drugs and at least put aside any traditional practices that they have for that period.
Quite. So when people come like this, there must be some management to look after them. Even some money is needed to start the work. I don't know how it happened, but within a month, when I came from Burma, within a month a course was held. And once one course was held, those who got benefited, they couldn't resist. Please give one more course. My father will come, my mother will come, my son will come, my brother will come, my friend will come. And like this, it started rolling. I had no difficulty.
I should also just go back and mention briefly and really ask you that you learned this teaching from a master in Burma at a time when you were struggling with what you thought was a psychosomatic ailment and used to get very severe headaches. Mm-hmm. And you went to this teacher to learn Vipassana, to address a specific problem. Mm. And then what happened? If you could tell us briefly.
He totally refused me. He said, don't come to me. If you want to get your migraine treated, better go to some doctors. You are devaluing the teaching which is so high, spiritual teaching, and you want to make use of it for your physical ailment?
To cure a headache.
To cure headaches. Yeah. Totally out of question. And that attracted me towards this saintly person. He was a householder, he was a government officer, he was the first accountant general of independent Burma, and he knew that I am from the standard of Burma at that time was a business magnate, industries, business, and president of the Rangoon Chamber of Commerce and Industry, and so many things, and very close to the ministers and prime ministers. One would have been very happy to have this person as a disciple. Mm-hmm. And he says, go away. Mm-hmm. I can't teach you. Whenever you want to have your mind purified, come. The gates are open. Mm-hmm. But if you come for any kind of curing the ailments, bodily ailments, I'm not going to teach you. That affected me. Mm-hmm. And then he explained what the teaching is. He said, you are leader of the Hindu community in Burma. Mm-hmm. Tell me, in your religion, is there any objection to Shila, that means morality? Mm-hmm. How can there be objection? Mm-hmm. Morality is accepted by every religion of the world. My religion accepts it. I will teach you morality. Then he said, how can you live a moral life unless you have control over your mind? Mm-hmm. Samadhi. Oh, Samadhi is wonderful. In our scriptures, we keep on reading, that Muni and that Rishi went and had Samadhi and all that. If you teach me Samadhi, sir, I've got no objection. Samadhi alone will not help. It will just control your mind, purify the mind, just at the surface level. At the deep level, the behavior pattern remains the same. You keep on generating defilement after defilement. For that, I teach you Panya, in Pali called Panya. In Sanskrit, we say Pragya. And that will help you to purify the mind at the deepest level. Any objection to Pragya? Pragya. I have been teaching Gita to my people. Mm-hmm. Sit Pragya, Shaka, Bhasha, what is Sit Pragya and all that. Somebody teaches me Pragya. No, no objection. That's all. Sila, Samadhi, Panya, nothing else. Still I had hesitation. Hesitation was that this is Buddhism. And this is Buddhist path. And these people don't believe in soul, they don't believe in God, they are Gnostic. Mm-hmm. If I become Gnostic, what will happen? I will go to hell. So yes, sir, I will come. I'll come, sir, but let me think over. It took me a few months more when I decided, let me give a trial, let me see what happens. And then when I passed through it, I found this is applied Gita, practical Gita. Mere intellectual understanding the theory does not help. It gives inspiration, it gives guidance, but you can't get the fruits. Merely accepting truth at the devotional level is good. It gives inspiration, it gives guidance. It can't give fruits. It is the practical side which gives the fruit. And here, these people are teaching the practical aspect of Dharma that attracted me. And then the wonderful results that started coming. I was such an ego-centered person. And that made this migraine so severe. In my mid-20s, I was so successful in life. Unbelievable. And that pride and ego, look, I'm such an intelligent person. Oh, I'm like this. That ego made me a very short-tempered person. Mm-hmm. All the time, angry on this reason, angry for that, angry for this, and then repenting afterwards, why I should have said these words, why I did like this, I should not have done that. Yet, I continued. Change started coming, even by the first course. And the defilement started passing away. I started living a very happy life, peaceful life. Then I took my friends and all, perhaps something, some magic or miracle has been done, and that's why I'm getting this benefit. Why not you also try? Hundreds of my Indian friends went to this teacher for the same result.
You mentioned this aspect of happiness. And obviously, you know, there are different notions of happiness, and that is part of the problem. That, sort of the popular culture, the popular media will tell us that if you get the next best car, or you get a beautiful wife, or a handsome husband, or what have you, that you will somehow be happy. What is the notion of happiness?
The happiness, which is because of these so-called sensual pleasures, we don't say that there's no happiness, because they are so ephemeral. And when you experience these happinesses, out of madness, out of ignorance, you develop tremendous amount of attachment to it. and this is not eternal.
So what is eternal? What is the eternal?
Eternal is the equanimity of the mind, and the eternal is something beyond mind and matter. You start this real happiness with the equanimity of the mind. You try to maintain that equanimity as long at a stretch as possible. And then purifying the mind, you transcend the entire field of mind and matter. You transcend the entire field of sensorium. And that is the stage which is real happiness.
Is that nirvana?
Nirvana. One calls nirvana, one may call moksha, one may call mukti. Or if somebody wants to say God Almighty, all right. We are not here to quarrel with the words.
Do you feel you have reached and experienced that stage?
Well, to some extent, if I had not reached, I could not teach others. In this tradition, one does not say much about oneself. I simply say that I am a tremendously changed person from what I started 45 years ago.
Do you have any aspirations, goals for yourself? Would you just feel you have reached that stage of equanimity and you just carry on and surrender?
That comes naturally, step by step. I won't have to strive for that. Now the goal is, I had a great misconception about Buddha's teaching. We have great respect for Buddha. In my poetries in Hindi, I use so laudable words about Buddha. Just like Rama, like Krishna, so Buddha, avatara. But his teaching, no good. Teaching is not good. This is Bodha Dharma. I was trained that way. And when I passed through all day, there is nothing which I can find in any way wrong. It is pure dharma, nothing else. Sila, samadhi, pragya, what's wrong in it? Maitri, karuna, what's wrong in it? Then I studied the words of Buddha, the Tipitaka, in Pali language, the original.
So your goal is to redress that misunderstanding.
Exactly. Then
the
I
teachings.
Studied our Puranas, our scriptures here, and I found last 1,500 years, so many things are said about Buddha's teaching which are totally wrong, baseless. So now let people know. I say sometimes that a great son of our country was banished. Now let us call him back. He got glory everywhere in the world, but we missed his teaching. Now let us make use of him and his teaching, especially today when the country needs so much. So much of division because of casteism, because of communalism, sectarianism. So very much unhappiness there is in the country. If this comes up, all these difficulties will go.
Acharya Goenka, thank you very much. This has been a great blessing.
Yes.